So much has been written about on how characters and features from the great Sanskrit epics and the Harivansha were transformed in corresponding works of the Jaina literature and were incorporated in the universal history of the Jainas. Considerably less attention has been given to possible borrowings in the opposite direction, except for two articles by Padmanabh S. Jaini discussing the adaptation of the Jinnah Rishabha as an avatar of Vishnu in the Bhagavata Purana, especially in his article in the SOAS Bulletin of 1977, reprinted in his collected papers on Jaina studies. Jaini gives a detailed account of the biography of Rishabha as presented in the Bhagavata Purana, whose author had raised Rishabha to the position of an avatar of Vishnu. According to Jaini, it is highly probable that the Bhagavata Purana took details of Rishabha's life over from Jinnasena's Adi Purana and polemicized against the criticism of the Brahmin caste in Jinnasena's work. I would agree for more than one reason that the polemics against the criticism of Brahmins, found particularly in a solemn speech put into Rishabha's mouth, are in response to Jinnasena. But I would rather doubt that the details of Rishabha's life, as presented in the Bhagavata Purana, are owed to Jinnasena's Adi Purana. These details, as far as they were not actually invented by the author of the Bhagavata Purana, are also present in other earlier sources. Moreover, there is in the Bhagavata Purana, apart from some divergences concerning Rishabha's biography, no sign of Bharata's story having anything to do with a brother named Bahubali, who is so popular in the South Indian tradition and partly even in the non-canonical Northern Jaina tradition. But it is not known to the Angas or Uvangas of the Shvetambara canon. My paper therefore traces earlier references to Jinnah Rishabha and his son Bharata in Hindu Puranas and investigates what might have been their Jaina sources. The most influential source for the composition of the Bhagavata Purana was no doubt the Vishnu Purana, as I have shown elsewhere. Even if it seems to understand itself officially as an improved revision or complement of the Mahabharata. From book three onward, it follows the Vishnu Purana in its overall Puranic agenda, which is based on the traditional five topics of a Purana, Purana Panchalakshana. The Vishnu Purana and with it the Bhagavata Purana deviates from the scheme, however, in one significant point. It includes, in the section about the genealogies of the patriarchs, the Vansha, the cosmography, a topic which in most other Puranas that follow the Purana Panchalakshana agenda is not included in the traditional set of the five topics. It is in this context that Rishabha's biography is briefly presented in the Vishnu Purana as belonging to the genealogy of Priyavrata, a son of Manu Svayambhuva. This specific genealogy seems to appear only in two or three other Puranas, which are actually considered to be older than the Vishnu Purana, the Vayu and Brahmanda Purana, originally identical, and the Markandeya Purana. And these Puranas also combine the genealogy of Priyavrata, to which Rishabha and his son Bharata belong, with the cosmography, starting with the geography of the earth, which is closely interlinked with Priyavrata and his progeny. All other Puranas that follow the traditional Purana Panchalakshana scheme are silent about Priyavrata's progeny and do not include the geography or cosmography anywhere within these five topics. In the Vayu and Brahmanda Purana, we learn about Rishabha. Illustrious Nabi begot on Marudevi, a son named Rishabha, the best of kings, the firstborn of the Kshatriya caste. From Rishabha, the hero Bharata was born as the eldest of 100 sons. After anointing his son, Rishabha set out for renunciation, pravrajya. That is, he took up the life of a wandering religious mendicant. The Markandeya Purana adds a further half sloka. He practiced austerities, an eminent ascetic, taking his abode in Pulaha's hermitage. So it seems that in this relatively old group of Puranas, Rishabha, the son of Nabi, was a king in the Manusvayambhuva era who gave up his kingdom in order to follow the ascetic path to salvation. There is no doubt an affinity with the Jaina tradition, even if the mention of Pulaha's hermitage points to a Brahmanic context. It would be difficult to decide whether the Puranic Rishabha is actually based on Jaina lore, or whether this is a genuinely Puranic side tradition from which the Jainas took over Rishabha as the first king, who then became also their first Jinnah, according to the Jambudvipa Prajnapti as well as Bhadrabahu's Kalpa Sutra. There do not seem to be any earlier direct references to Rishabha in the Jaina canonic literature. As for the Vishnu Purana, it is presumably based on the Markandeya Purana in presenting this particular section of the Puranic Vansha topic, combining the genealogy of Priyavrata with a description of the earth. The author of this Purana has now to offer more details concerning the life of Rishabha, and some of these are certainly influenced by Jaina lore, which must have been well established by the time of the composition of the Vishnu Purana. His, that is Nabi's, son from Meru Devi was the illustrious Rishabha. From Rishabha was born Bharata. He was the eldest of 100 of sons. After ruling his kingdom according to his dharma, performing all kinds of sacrifices and consecrating his eldest son Bharata as king, the eminent Rishabha went to the hermitage of Pulastya for practicing asceticism. Having decided to live there in accordance with the rules of retirement to the forest, he practiced austerities as it should be done. And when this lord of the earth, emaciated by his austerities, had become extremely slim, with his veins trained like cords, naked, putting a pebble in his mouth, he followed the path of the heroes, which means he fasted to death. Here the last shloka points clearly to the Jaina tradition. The term Vira, hero, is used abundantly in the Ayaranga Sutta as an epithet of the true ascetic who is indifferent to enjoyment or pain, who does not mind if he is not provided with arms, who avoids any contact with the world, and who follows the difficult path which leads to whence there is no return. The last bit is Ayaranga 1441. That he was naked is in agreement with all visual presentations of Rishabha. You see one there. What can be concluded from the Vishnu Purana evidence is that its author, even if he based his account on the Markandeya Purana, was no doubt also acquainted with some parts of the Jaina tradition. If one takes the somewhat extraordinary last chapter of book 3 in the Vishnu Purana into consideration as well, where the terms arhata for a follower of the jinnas and the term anekantavada as the main characteristic of their philosophy are used, one can even be more sure about the Vishnu Purana drawing on some parts of the Jaina doctrine available at that time, and may reconsider the dating of the Vishnu Purana according to the occurrence of Anekantavada in Jaina texts, which seems to be later than the date usually assigned to the Vishnu Purana. As for the Bhagavata Purana, it provides even more details about Rishabha, but not only for him, but also for his ancestors, Priyavrata, Agnidra, Nabi, who are all honored with a special chapter telling their lives. The reason for Rishabha being in an avatara of Vishnu is already given at the end of Nabi's story. It seems to be in order to teach a special kind of asceticism involving nakedness, termed here Vata Rashana. In the three chapters dedicated to Rishabha, some more features, which had not been mentioned in the Vishnu Purana, have been taken over from the Jaina tradition. That is, for instance, his role as a teacher of arts and crafts to his people, as found in the Jambudvipa Prajnapti or in the Kalpa Sutra, has been elevated to teaching the right dharma to his subjects. A special chapter has been devoted to a speech of his, which is first about the right kind of spiritual life, but it ends, which could refer to more than one ascetic tradition, but it ends in a eulogy of the Brahmins, which may indeed be a polemic against Jinnasena's Adi Purana, as P.S. Jaini suggested. His life as an ascetic is also depicted in more detail, even his outward appearance, which agrees with well-known images of Rushabha, the heavier one, no, with the locks and so on, and the death of his wandering empty body in a forest fire, which is of course not in agreement with the Jaina tradition. Looking at the parallel features in Jaina and Hindu Purana traditions, one has of course to be aware that both accounts appear in their own historical frame, which is in both cases a time long before our historical time. In the Hindu tradition, Rishabha belongs to the descendants of a son of Manu Svayambhuva, three Manu periods away from our present Manu Vaivasvata. Similarly, in the Jaina tradition, Rishabha belongs to a period far earlier than ours, to the end of the Sushama-Dushama period, with all other Jinnas still to follow in the Dushama-Sushama period, which ended with Mahavira. But probably the distance in time facilitated the acceptance of Rishabha in both traditions. Contemporary Jainas, and possibly Mahavira, were presented with considerably more negative criticism in both the Vishnu and Bhagavata Puranas, as has been pointed out already and discussed by P.S. Jaini. Turning now to Bharata, in the accounts of all five Puranas that present Priyavrata's genealogy, Bharata is identified as the oldest son of Rishabha, after whom the region south of the snow mountain was named Bharatavarsha. To Rishabha was born the valorous Bharata as the first before 100 sons. Having consecrated him as king, Rishabha set off for the life of an ascetic. He gave the southern section of Jambudvipa, which had called Himahva after the snow mountain, to Bharata. That is why the wise know it by the name Bharatavarsha. This was the early three Puranas, Vayu, Brahmanda, Markandeya. The Vishnu Purana has a little more. That is why this region is famous as Bharatavarsha, since it was given to Bharata by his father when he set off for the forest. None of the Puranas offers a more convincing explanation why the subcontinent should be named after him and not after somebody else in his family line. Nor does the Jambudvipa Prajnapti associate this name with the first Chakravartin Bharata, but states that it is an eternal name that has always been there. Probably the name referred originally to a tribe or clan known already in the Rig Veda, and its country was named after them from Vedic times onward. The Puranic account agrees on the whole with the traditional Jaina universal history, in which Bharata, the first emperor, or Chakravartin, is regarded as the eldest son of Rishabha. The first occurrence of his name in the Jaina canon in Uttarajaya attests him indeed as the first ruler in a sequence of 12 or 16, he who gave up his kingdom called Bharahamvasam after coming to know about the pure faith of the Jinnas. Having learned this pure creed, which is adorned by truth and righteousness, Bharata gave up Bharatavarsha and all pleasures and entered the order. That's the translation of Jacobi. But there is no mentioning of his family. He is not even called a Chakravartin here. But one has to assume that Bharaham or Bharahamvasam referred to the subcontinent, as also in the case of three or four others of his successors. In the Upanga text, Jambudvipa Prajnapti, which gives the first extensive account of Rishabha's and Bharata's lives, Bharata is not mentioned among the 100 sons of Rishabha, to each of whom Rishabha gave a kingdom. And in the section about Bharata's conquest of the earth, Bharata is said to be born in a noble royal family, which is not further identified. The first Jaina source to connect the two names as being father and sons is probably the Avashyakana Yukti, followed by other accounts of the universal history, like Sri Lanka's Chaupana, Mahapurisacharya, and later Sanskrit texts. And we would have learned something from Bansidabhat, no doubt about that. All the Puranic texts dealt with in my paper agree with the oldest attestation in the Jaina canon in reporting that Bharata resigned his Kal kingdom and adopted the life of a hermit. The Vayu and Brahmanda Purana have the following account. Bharata's son was the knowledgeable Sumati, following the Dharma. To him, Bharata entrusted the kingdom. Having transferred his royal power to his son, the king entered the forest. The Markandeya Purana does not differ greatly from this. The Vishnu Purana has, as usual, a little more to offer. Bharata's son was Sumati, highly knowledgeable about the Dharma. To him, his father, performing sacrifices, gave the empire after making it complete. I'm not quite sure about that. Having transferred his royal power to his son, King Bharata gave up his life in Shalagrama, O hermit, on account of being engaged with yoga. And he was reborn as a Brahmin in an excellent family of yogis. Maitreya, I'll tell you his life story again later. This is, of course, an interesting deviation from the common traditions. Such a rebirth is not mentioned either in Jaina sources or in the other Puranas, except for the Bhagavata Purana, as usual. Perhaps even more interesting is the fact that when the story is indeed taken up in a sort of appendix in the last four chapters of the Vishnu Purana's second book after the topic of cosmography is concluded, the details of Bharata's life in the forest are changed. He does not give up his life in practicing yoga, but staying as a hermit in Shalagrama, he brings up a little fawn whose mother was killed by a lion and gets so much attached to it that when he dies, he thinks of this fawn only and is consequently reborn as a deer. After an austere life as a deer, he is again reborn, this time at last in a family of yogins. But he turns out to be a very untypical Brahmin, behaving like a stupid idiot, Jada. Nevertheless, he develops deep philosophical thoughts. Serving as a palanquin bearer to a king, he teaches the king divine knowledge and ultimately reaches liberation. Followed by a special Falastuti, indicating that it may have been an independent text piece. The story is taken up also in the Bhagavata Purana, but here it is integrated more smoothly into Bharata's biography before the topic of cosmography is eventually presented. These two versions of the legend are compared in detail by Ernst Leumann in 1894. He suggests that it had its origin in the so-called Parivrajaka literature, since the name Jada Bharata, occurs in the Jabala Upanishad together with seven others in a list of Paramahansa monks who have reached the highest grade of world renunciation. This may very well be the case, since the story in the Vishnu Purana shows a significant use of the word Jada in different combinations, although the name Jada Bharata never occurs. The rebirth story may have been a convenient device for a Vaishnava text to connect the king Bharata with another ascetic strand that was probably in line with their own Advaita philosophy. The Hindu tradition knows, of course, of more than one Bharata, the most famous being another Chakravartin, Bharata, the son of Shakuntala, whose descendants are the protagonists in the great epic Mahabharata. He turns already up in the Aitareya Brahmana in a list of kings who conquered the world and performed a horse sacrifice, similarly in the Shatapatha Brahmana. And his name occurs in various lists of famous kings in consolation speeches in the Mahabharata, who in spite of their royal splendor had to face death. This is perhaps not so far away from the list of kings who gave up their royal splendor in order to follow the path of the Jinnas in the Uttarajaya, so there may be another point of contact there. To sum up, as for the connection of Bharata with Rishabha, there seems to be a common tradition in a few of the Puranas and the traditional Jaina universal history, which is not yet found in earlier canonical texts. But like the Jambudvipa Prajnapti, the Puranas have not adopted or did not want to adopt the Bahubali legend. Since exact data are very difficult to establish for either the earlier Puranas or the earlier Jaina text, it is very difficult to decide in which direction there may have been some borrowing, if there was some borrowing. One can, however, be quite sure that the Vishnu Purana, as well as the Bhagavata Purana, were familiar with several aspects of the Jaina tradition, including contemporary Jaina practices, which seem to have been viewed in a negative light, or their philosophical attitude, known as Anekantavada in the Vishnu Purana, which seems also to have introduced the device of rebirth stories, culminating in final emancipation, so common in Jaina narrative literature, into its discourse. But this topic requires further investigation. Thank you.